Good evening and welcome to Q&A. I'm Tony Jones, and answering your questions tonight, the Minister for Communications, Malcolm Turnbull, comedian and broadcaster, Dave Hughes, women's business advocate, Yolanda Vega, Shadow Attorney General, Mark Dreyfus, and columnist for the Australian newspaper, Janet Albrechtsen. Please welcome our panel. And as usual, we're being simulcast on ABC News 24 and News Radio, and you can join the Twitter conversation or send us a question by using the Qanda hashtag on your screen. Well, there are some important Australian political issues on the Q&A agenda tonight. Before we get to those, let's turn briefly to the Winter Olympics in Sochi with our first question from Pat Bergen.
My question's to Malcolm Turnbull. Malcolm, imagine you're a young gay man competing in the luge at the Sochi Winter Olympic Games. You win a medal. Do you use your moment of glory to protest against Russia's anti-gay propaganda laws, or refrain, despite one of the fundamentals of Olympism being the right to practice sport without discrimination of any kind?
Well, Malcolm Turnbull. Well, let's go back to when you were a young gay man.
Yeah, that's right. And fascinated with the luge, yeah, which I've heard described as being symbolic of the life of the Labor Party, starting at the top and descending downhill at a great pace.
Don't steal a warm-up joke.
Why not? Plagiarism is the sincerest form of flattery, you know that. I think that's a difficult question of judgment, but it because the successful competitor has got a great opportunity and a big audience there. On the other hand, it being held in Russia, they might just pull the cable and the screen would go to black. So he might be better off taking the medal and then making a protest somewhere where he can be, you know, better assured of getting it all out to air. I don't know. But it's certainly discrimination against gay people is outrageous. It certainly is inconsistent with the Olympic tradition. And, I would certainly support any protest of that kind.
So, what, you'd support Australian athletes standing on the podium making a protest a la the Black Power protests in 68?
No, I'm just saying, look, it's a matter for them, Tony. It is absolutely a matter for them. It's not they're not there to take my advice as a politician. But I think if people are being oppressed, if people are being discriminated against, then the only way they can rectify or address that discrimination is by standing up and making a protest. Having said that, you've got to pick your moment wisely and tactically, and that's my only observation.
But don't protest during the event. If you're going down the luge, keep your flag in your pants.
What do you put yourself on that podium, Dave? What do you do?
You'd have to protest. I mean, absolutely. It's what a proud moment. You're a winner and, you know, and you're proudly gay, and it would be the perfect moment to protest.
Let's hear from Janet Albrechtsen. What do you think?
I agree with Malcolm that I think you do pick your moment. I don't think there's, you know, a hard and fast rule here. I probably would tend to think that the podium is about sport, and when you win a medal, it's about your genius as a sportsman or woman. So in that sense, I guess I prefer that, you know, that sportsmen and women use press conferences, social media, other forms, and I think they're in an incredibly powerful position to do that, especially if they've won medals. And in this sense, you know, it's terrific that the Olympics are in Russia because of the focus that has been put on these anti-gay laws in Russia. So it's fantastic that we're talking about it, and I think it's great that sportsmen and women are talking about how they might protest it. I'm just not sure the podium is the right place to do it.
Yolanda, what do you think? I mean, 68, what a lot of people remember about that particular Olympics is the two black American athletes standing, giving the Black Power salute, the Australian athlete who won the silver medal, standing next to them, wearing a badge to support both of them.
Absolutely, and we've also got the Australian example where the Indigenous flag was flown. So I think any opportunity for a minority to stand up and protest against discrimination is absolutely valuable, and, you know, there are some parallels here between the gay movement and what women went through 100 years ago. If we hadn't protested, we would still have issues with getting the vote. You know, we've been protesting about equal pay for some time now and we're still protesting. So I think any opportunity to stop discrimination needs to be heard, and take any social media or any type of medium that you can in order to get the word out there.
It's only early days. We haven't seen any protests, as far as I know so far, certainly none that have made the news. Do you think there will be or should be?
I think there should be, absolutely. Mm. If there's discrimination, their voices need to be heard.
Mark Dreyfus, what do you think?
I think all Australians would deplore the laws in Russia against homosexuality, and I think that there should be protests, and I think there's a great tradition of protest at the Olympic Games. A bit like Malcolm, I'm not saying there should be disruption, but we can think back to, as you've said, Tony, the Mexico City Games. You go further back and think of the British athlete who refused to dip the Union Jack on the march past of the dais with Hitler at Berlin. And that was another way of making a very clear protest.
All right, let's move on, because we've got a lot of domestic subjects to get onto. And our first question on that subject, or on other subjects, is from Joe Ortenzi.
Hi, my question is from Malcolm Turnbull. If we really want to get to the bottom of illegality in unions, why does the government prefer a royal commission, which is expensive, has no significant powers, and may preclude any legal activity, rather than a police investigation, which would exert the rule of law? It looks to many of us like a desire to keep it a political rather than a criminal decision.
Well, thank you for that. The royal commissions do actually have quite a lot of power, because they can compel witnesses to attend and give evidence and compel the production of documents and things. So they are pretty powerful. But you make a good point about police actions and prosecutions, and royal commissioners can't, they can recommend that prosecutors look at things, but they can't actually bring a prosecution. Where you've got one isolated criminal activity or suspected criminal activity, I think it is fair to say, leave the police to get on with it. But when you've got such a pattern, what appears to be a systemic pattern of corruption, and we've seen so many examples over the last few years, including the most recent ones chronicled on the 730 report, then people are saying, well, there's something very big and bad going on here, and that is the right environment for a royal commission to look at it overall.
Isn't there corruption in all forms of, you know, industry, though? I mean, seriously, there's some corruption in unions. Like, what's the next royal commission going to be? Whether is water wet? I mean, like, isn't it a waste of a lot of money? I mean, we had one 9 years ago. I mean, can't we just use that report again?
Well, I reckon, look, Dave, you're a great comic, but that was not your best gag. The fact is... This is deadly serious. Trade unions represent working Australians, not all working Australians, but many working Australians, and they are dealing with other people's money and other people's lives and destinies. And if that money is being abused and ripped off and stolen, and we have seen plenty of evidence that it is, and if the system of governance of those unions and their associated entities and slush funds is not actually being picked up, and it appears to be happening on a large scale, then I think there is a case for a royal commission, and that was the decision the government came to today. But the gentleman is quite right. If it was just one particular case, one isolated case, then that is much better off dealt with by the police, but that is not what we're dealing with here.
Malcolm Turnbull, just go to the latter part of the question. Is there any doubt in your mind that this Royal Commission will have political consequences for the Labor Party?
Well, I mean, it could have. I mean, really, the Labor Party was founded by the trade union movement, but that does not mean that you can attached to the Labor Party criminal activity in certain trade unions. So I think whether it has political consequences...
Well, Tony Abbott talks about Bill Shorten protecting the protection rate, for example. This seems to be the start of what we may see for a year.
I think what the Prime Minister is saying is that Bill Shorten should, having run a big union himself, having seen so much evidence of criminal activity, inappropriate activity, corrupt activity, what he should do is say, OK, you know, let the sun shine in and let's see what's been going on. And it is sunshine is a very, very good antidote to corruption. Letting the light, as Tony Abbott said, into the dark places of Australian life is a very important function. Now, I'm not a unbridled fan of royal commissions, believe me. They can run off the rails if they're not well run, so I'm very pleased to see Dyson Heydon as the royal commissioner, and they've got to be very carefully managed by the royal commissioner.
Just briefly, before we pass on to the other panellists, do you expect that Julia Gillard, among others, could be called before the royal commission? In this case, the terms of reference talk about both slush funds or funds in union movements and the AWU. So both of those things are there to call upon Julie Gillard to answer questions if necessary.
Well, Tony, I don't want to speculate on that. I mean, that is very much a matter for the Royal Commissioner and the Royal Commission when established.
It's just a pure matter of logic, though, isn't it? I mean, I'm asking your opinion here.
Well, you're asking my opinion, but given that I'm a member of the Cabinet and this is... Royal Commission's just been decided on by the Cabinet today and we've appointed a Royal Commissioner.
But it's not a Cabinet decision whether Julia Gillard appears before a Royal Commission.
Well, of course not. That's the whole point.
You would hope not, wouldn't you?
Look, you're not... The pair of you, I don't know whether you're... I don't know whether you're the siren song or whether you're sort of... some kind of perilous entreaty, Skiller and Charybdis, perhaps. but in any event, I'm not going
don't
to be drawn.
Don't use words I don't know.
I'm not going to be drawn into expressing an opinion about who may or may not be called. Can I just make one point that the gentleman touched on, but this is an important one because it may well be raised. Some people have said, what about cases where criminal proceedings are pending? You know, where there is a lot, where the prosecutor has a very good brief. And will this Royal Commission interfere with that? Now, the answer to that is, of course, the Royal Commissioner has a great deal of discretion. He, and it is a he in this case, can choose to not deal with a matter that is likely to be prosecuted or about to be prosecuted, or he can deal with it in camera and make a direction that the evidence not be published. So there is plenty of scope. There is no reason why this Royal Commission will impede the prosecution of people where there is a prosecutor's brief ready to go.
OK, you've answered a question that wasn't asked, but that's all right. Let's hear from Mark Dreyfus and then I'll hear from the other panellists. The question was whether it's necessary to have a Royal Commission and whether it will end up being political.
Yeah, to go back to Joe's question and just to clear up one thing at the start, Malcolm's right to say, contrary to Joe's suggestion, that Royal Commissions do have powers and quite extensive powers. And so too does the Australian Crime Commission. It's got all of the powers that a Royal Commission has to compel the attendance of witnesses, to require witnesses to answer questions, and more importantly, to work with the Australian Federal Police, state police forces, territory police forces, and that's why Labor has said very clearly about this, that's what should be happening. We deplore corruption anywhere in Australian society. We deplore breaking the law, whether it be in unions or corporations or anywhere else. And absolutely, the full force of the law should be brought to bear. But our concern is, and we have regrettably an example from 2001 to 2003, that having a Royal Commission spending $66 million, that one cost, didn't produce a single serious prosecution. That'd be $100 million in today's money.
Well, can I just interrupt there because George Brandis seems to have taken up part of your suggestion and he's talking about the possibility of having a police task force running inside or alongside the Royal Commission. So, sounds like you've got your wish there. Well, you could have a prosecutorial body acting within the Royal Commission. There could be police powers
Not within the Royal Commission. They'll have to be kept separate. But if
the government takes
up Labor's suggestion of a task force, that's a very good thing. We're concerned that it's actually a waste of money on a political exercise. The Australian Crime Commission's budget's a bit over $100 million, and that's in a year. This Royal Commission could well spend almost the whole of the Crime Commission's budget and not get a single prosecution,
possibly impede investigations. Quick question on the politics. I mentioned this to Malcolm Turnbull. If Julia Gillard were called, could she refuse to go against... could she refuse to actually give evidence at this Royal Commission or will she be compelled?
Well, I'm not going to speculate about what this Royal Commission could do, but
does it have the powers to compel former politicians, even former prime ministers, to appear before it?
Royal Commissions have power to compel all Australian citizens and people resident here to appear and to answer questions. The fact that you're speculating about it, I think, shows the political exercise that this is. And I invite the government to reconsider. And if the government is going to set up a police task force, as we have suggested, that's a very good thing. There's some tremendous successes that the Australian Crime Commission, I accept, Malcolm, I've been Attorney General recently. I'm probably more familiar with what the police can do. There have been some very successful work done by the Australian Crime Commission on combating systemic corruption in customs.
You've lost that battle. The Royal Commission has been called, the Commissioner has been called. Now we need to think about what will happen. Are you worried that every former union official that entered politics could be looking over their shoulder over the next year?
I'm worried that this Royal Commission is going to delay and impede proper investigation by the criminal investigation agencies. This Royal Commission can't charge anyone. This Royal Commission can't prosecute anyone. The resources should be going into our police agencies to get on with this.
All right, Janet Albrechtsen.
Well, they can work in tandem, Mark, as George Brandis said today, and I think it's important that the Royal Commission does work in tandem with the police on this. I mean, the problem with police enforcement is that people have not been forthcoming in terms of the allegations that we've seen of corruption and standover tactics and worse. And if they haven't been forthcoming, it's been virtually impossible for the police to do anything. We saw that today with comments from the Victorian Deputy Police Commissioner, who said that very thing, that as much as he would like to prosecute, if people are not willing to make statements and they don't come forward, they haven't been able to prosecute. But what a Royal Commission does, it sets up an institutional structure where a whistleblower can rely on that structure to come forward and to tell all. And previously, what we've relied on is a whistleblower to come out, you know, at huge threat to their own safety and so on, to reveal what we know, or what, the allegations that have been made, you know, in relation to the TWU, the HSU and the CFMEU. Now, if that doesn't suggest that there is a bigger problem that requires a national response in terms of a Royal Commission, I don't know what does. And I think it's interesting to go back and look at Julia Gillard's comments when she set up the Royal Commission into institutional child abuse. That was based on the allegations of one police officer. That's what kicked that off. And good on her for doing that. She said we needed a national response to what seemed to be a systemic problem in Australia. It's not dissimilar. Child abuse is not union corruption, but it's a systemic problem that needs to be dealt with. And the other thing that happened when Julia Gillard came out and announced that Royal Commission was that she got support from Tony Abbott. She got support from the Archbishop of Sydney, George Pell, who said that clearly the public are not certain that this issue is being dealt with adequately by the Catholic Church. And he said it was important that the truth be told. Now, I would have thought that the union movement would take the same attitude, that the public are not certain that these issues have been dealt with adequately and that the truth need to be told.
You've got a question, has got a hand up there. We'll quickly go back to you.
Well, just to follow on from that, if we start looking at the Catholic Church to see about progress with internal commissions, we have a really good example of something that keeps coming forward, but there are very few, if any, criminal prosecutions. And I guess people are concerned that with this commission, we'll be having a lot of talk leading towards election time before anything occurs from it, whereas we know that in criminal procedures, that can happen much more quickly. And I think people would be keen to see that kind of quick and swift activity rather than a long, drawn-out process with more and more and more witnesses brought forward.
Thank you very much. I'll take that as a comment. Now, 2 weeks ago, Federal Cabinet decided not to bail out the SPC Ardmona food processing plant in Victoria. Today, Toyota announced that, like Holden and Ford, it'll close down car manufacturing in Australia over the next few years. These shutdowns will cost tens of thousands of jobs in Victoria and South Australia, but should governments interfere? Our next question comes from Mitchell Comans.
Hi, thank you. My question's for the panel generally. Why are there so many people, and they're on both sides of politics, who refuse to let our competitive businesses die quickly? If we don't want to eat tin fruit or drive Holden Commodores, why are we fighting that? Personally, I enjoy not living in 1983, and I wonder why other people don't feel the same way.
Yolanda, let's hear from you.
Great comment, Mitchell. Thank you for that. The point is that we are living in a capitalist society, and where there is supply and demand, we have to adhere to that. Now, we keep seeing... I believe that we seem to keep making the same mistakes. There's these massive businesses that keep getting bailed out, and yet the small businesses of Australia, which make up 96%, are completely ignored. Do you know of any coffee shop owners or any mechanics that get this massive quantity of money from the grant simply because their business model no longer works? No. So I think here we've got an issue where if it's good for the goose, it's got to be good for the gander. And the majority of small businesses in Australia aren't requesting handouts, so I don't understand why big businesses that are making extraordinary profits seem to think that they can continue asking for money from the taxpayer. I think it's unacceptable.
Thank you. What do you think?
I appreciate what Yolanda said, but I think you can disconnect this from small business. I mean, we are still eating tinned fruit and we're driving cars, but they're from overseas because they're often the tinned fruit's being dumped here illegally. We're getting no protection for local industries. There's no tariffs at all anymore. I mean, there's half the brands of cars that are sold in America, they sell half as many brands as we sell. Like, they don't let cars to be imported like we do. I mean, there's 300 million people in America. They're buying half the amount of cars that... brands that we're buying. There's no protection at all anymore for local industry, and that's why it's dying.
Malcolm Turnbull.
Yes.
I thought you might like to contribute to the discussion.
All right, sorry.
Silly me.
No, I'd had a good go earlier. I didn't want to. I didn't want to just be accused of answering questions that hadn't been asked. Well, assuming you're asking me, sort of Kerry O'Brien-like, to respond to a comment.
No, not at all. I'm asking you to respond to the question.
Okay, the question.
Who raises the prospect? That one should be hard line when it comes to protection of dying industries.
Well,
they're not dying in other countries.
Let's just delete the word dying. The real question that Yolanda poses in answer to your question, sir, which I think the real point she's making is a very, very powerful one, is, and you take SPC Admona as a good example of this, why should the Commonwealth government, using $25 million of taxpayers' money, give that as a gift to Coca-Cola Amatil to improve its return on its investment in SPC Ardmona by 1%. Now, if you walked around all of the small businesses in Sydney and a lot of the medium-sized businesses anywhere in Australia, and you said, would your returns be improved by a bit if we gave you $25 million or perhaps just $2 million? I mean, of course they'd think you were nuts.
That's a ridiculous statement.
No, it's not a ridiculous statement. Coca-Cola Amatil, which is the owns SPC Ardmona, is a $9 billion market capitalisation company, giant company. It's making hundreds of millions of dollars of profit, and it was asking for free money from the federal government and the Victorian government in order to improve its return on the investment it was proposing to make into SPC Ardmona by about 1%. And, you know, I just don't think that washes with the thousands and thousands of other businesses in Australia that, as Yolanda said, are not putting their hands out
for
subsidies.
But what if a local area dies because of that? What if Shepparton no longer, everyone just leaves because you wouldn't put in $25 million?
Dave, the great mistake that we make is that we talk about jobs being lost, but we forget about jobs being created. The reality is this. Every time you use a dollar taken in taxes from businesses that are not getting subsidies and give it to a business that... wants subsidies, you are putting a cost on the businesses that are profitable and for the sake of propping up a business which is not. Now, you know, that is a general proposition. There are all sorts of circumstances where you might get somebody over a temporary hollow
forth. Can I bring you to today's huge event, which is the Toyota's decision. That's the last car maker in Australia. That means the end of car making in Australia. Now, the writing was on the wall that if you pulled all support out from underneath the car industry, this would happen. Did the federal government realise when it decided...
The federal government has not pulled out all support from the car industry. That for a start, is untrue. You're misrepresenting things, but as a fact, we have not pulled out support from the car industry. Mr. Yasuda made it very clear what the problems were. Below-scale manufacturing. I mean, you need to have a plant that is making somewhere between, 250, 300,000 or even 400,000 vehicles a year. That scale is not available. to Toyota, so that, or indeed to Ford or General Motors. So the scale is not there in the Australian market. A very high Aussie dollar. And, of course, manufacturing costs, which, as Ford and General Motors said to the Productivity Commission just recently, are twice as high as those in Europe and four times as high as those in Asia. So, you know, that is that's the problem. It's not... The fact is that, according to the Productivity Commission, in the last 15 years, coupling tariffs and subsidies, about $30 billion of government assistance has gone to the car industry. $30 billion.
OK. I'm not trying to cut you off, but we do need to hear from other panellists. Mark, sure. Dreyfus.
Thanks, Tony. I'm thinking of the workers at Toyota, the 2,500 workers at Toyota and their families and the communities that depend on them. I'm thinking of the nearly 3,000 workers in Shepparton who are going to lose their jobs if SPC goes under. And I'm thinking of the hundreds of thousands of workers in the whole of the car industry, particularly automotive components firms, of which there's somewhere between 100 and 200 in Australia. This is an interconnected industry which has got high skills, engineering skills, tremendous investment in research, and we have a government that is prepared to let the car industry and other Australian industries go to the wall without regard to the significance of those industries in their communities. The disruption that is going to be caused in Victoria and in South Australia in particular, but right across the country by the death of the car industry, the disruption in Shepparton is going to be immense. It is going to take Australia years to recover from this. I don't accept that there's just this interchangeability, as Malcolm likes to talk over others, that they'll immediately, these workers, many of whom have worked all their lives in these factories, will walk into another job. We've got a government that does not care about honest Australian workers. We've got a government that doesn't care about the impact of letting companies go under, that doesn't want to understand how interconnected all of these companies and industries are and what Australia will be losing if, unlike all of the 13 countries that have got a car industry who all support it, all of those countries, their national governments support their car industries, we've unfortunately got a government which has lost sight of the damage that's going to be done to Australian communities and to the Australian economy by the decisions that they've made in the last 5 months.
OK, just hang on, because I'll bring in the other panellists, but we've got a few people with their hands up, and we'll hear first of all from the gentleman up the back. Go ahead.
What is the role of Coles and Woolies in this battle that seems to be with small businesses and the way they bring them down, literally, and make it very hard for them to compete? I went to Woolies and looked at...
We haven't got time to make a long speech here. I think we've got your basic point, though.
Basically, we'll just let that feed into the discussion.
The Woolies brand is 3 cents. Go on, we'll hear from this gentleman here.
Yeah, thanks. The Shadow Attorney General doesn't actually present any real solutions. The issue is that we're spending a lot of money on an industry that isn't functioning. Could that money not be spent to retool those skills into an industry that can be profitable? What initiatives are being developed?
Well, just to answer this second question and leave Coles and Woolworths for the moment, Shepparton's a really good example. If a company came to the federal or state government, a new company, leave out that it's Coca-Cola Amatil, but any company, and said, we're prepared to put $160 million into retooling this plant or building a new plant in Shepparton, and we ask you for a contribution, a co-contribution or co-investment of $25 million.
It's not a co-investment, it's a gift. It's not an investment at all.
You can use whatever language you like, but...
I'm using
federal
English.
Federal government...
English is good.
Federal government... Malcolm likes to use value-laden terms.
No, I just use
federal governments assist. Federal governments assist industries all over the country. We have not heard any coherent explanation from this government as to why it's okay to give $16 million to Cadbury's in Tasmania, owned by a parent company more profitable than Coca-Cola Amatil, or just last week, it's okay to give $3.5 million to a fish processing plant in Tasmania. Repeatedly, government ministers have been asked, what's the difference
Well, there were promises made in an election campaign. That's one big difference.
Well,
let's hear from Janet Albrechtsen.
That's not much of a distinction, Tony.
I'll tell you what's interesting here tonight, and that is that Mitchell's original question got such a round of applause. And I'll bet about, you know, 5-10 years ago, that would not have happened. I think there's been a sea change amongst voters on this issue, and that is simply because we have pumped so much money into the car industry that has not been profitable for years. You know, at Toyota, for example, over the last year they received, I think, $72 million. That's $29,000 per employee. Holden received, I think, $96 million. That's $50,000 per employee. They're still not profitable. They can't make cars, you know, let alone competing with China. Everyone talks about, oh, gosh, we can't compete with China. We can't even compete with Europe when we make cars in Australia because of the manufacturing costs. Now, the fact that there's been a sea change on this, I think, is incredibly important. And, it's, you know, whatever government you've got, whether it's Liberal or Labor, it's incredibly important that we have a government that takes a line here, because for too long, both parties, both Liberal and Labor, have been pouring money into the car industry. This day was always going to come. It's a dreadful day, I agree, Mark. It's a shocking day for the employees. It's not like they'll get a job tomorrow, but this is part of transitioning a country away from something that we did 20 years ago. And you know, union leaders talk about Australia being a country that has to manufacture things. Well, you have to finish the sentence. It has to be a country that manufactures things that people want to buy. I'm not buying tinned fruit. I don't buy tin fruit anymore, and I don't buy new cars.
Let's go back to this side of the panel. I'll hear from both of you, but just start with you, Malcolm Turnbull. Is there a plan? Does the federal government have a plan for what to do to help the thousands, tens of thousands of workers who are going to lose their jobs over the next few years?
Yeah, well, there will certainly be a plan. Well, there'll be announcements about assistance to those communities. But I'll tell you what the big plan is.
Well, you're giving new start to people who are facing drought. So is the plan to give them the dole?
People who are unemployed are entitled to the dole, obviously. But the real issue is creating new jobs. Now, in this very globalised, competitive world, we have to have industries which are globally competitive. That means that they have to be able to stand on their own two feet. They have to be smarter, more technologically advanced. We have to move up that value chain. We cannot compete in industries which are basic commodities unless, as we do in iron ore and coal, where we're at the low cost end, by and large, of that commodity curve. Manufacturing motor cars is not something that we can do competitively in Australia, and that's been obvious for a long time. Now, one of Mark's predecessors, Kim Carr, said you can't own a car industry, you can only rent it, meaning the government's just got to keep on subsidising more and more and more. And people have lost patience with that. And what I'm saying is the jobs that you want, the jobs that Australians want, the advanced, successful, technologically proficient industries that we need to have will be created when there is the freedom to get on with the job and you do not have so much of taxpayers' resources being diverted to prop up industries. We should be focused on creating jobs, on the new jobs. Focus on the future. And that's what we're committed to. That's why we say Australia is once again open for business. And that doesn't just mean open for businesses that are receiving taxpayer subsidies. It means open for new businesses, open for innovation.
It's a great answer. It's all very well to say we're open for business, but we have to do stuff. And can I just say the first new car I ever bought was a purple Corolla, and I'll never forget it. It was a beautiful car. And and so many people have put so much of their time and effort into making great cars in Australia. It's a really sad day.
It's a really sad day. I agree, it's a sad day.
All right, let's move on. We've got a few people with their hands up. We'll just take that gentleman up the back there.
Just wanted to ask Malcolm Turnbull if his remarks apply equally to the agriculture business.
Or to mining.
Well, look, if you're asking about agriculture, and there is obviously a very bad drought on, and there has been a long-standing practice of providing some support to farmers in exceptional circumstances when there are exceptionally bad droughts.
That is a
very different category to supporting an industry sending more and more money every year. The amount of, you know, our farmers are among the least subsidised
in the world, the least supported in the world. We have the most competitive agricultural sector in the world. That, you know, the countries we compete with subsidise their farmers. We do not. We give them some support in times of extreme drought, and that's, you know, that is about it.
OK, thank you, Malcolm Turnbull. Our next question, actually, sadly, it is to Malcolm Turnbull, but it's a video from Bobby Oakley, who lives on a farm in Nimitabelle in the snowy mountains of New South Wales. Bobby has no internet or mobile phone access on her property. And she told us she had to go to her neighbours next door to upload this question.
Dear panel and audience and viewers, are you aware that just before Christmas I was informed that the NBN satellite for satellite broadband for a lot of regional people, our only option, is now full. There is no room left on that satellite for us. There are over 30,000 people apparently registered or waiting to go on that satellite, and probably more than 200,000 people will need to be in the near future. Malcolm, this is a serious problem for us. We have no other options for the internet. Do you find this satisfactory?
No, I find it absolutely appalling, and I'll tell you exactly what happened. The previous government established what they called the interim satellite solution and bought some space on some satellites to deliver satellite services to people such as the lady from Nimitabelle, pending the arrival of the long-term satellites which are being built in the United States and will arrive in 2015. The government said that their interim satellite solution covered or passed sometimes 200,000 premises, sometimes 250,000 premises. What they didn't say was that they'd only bought enough capacity to cover 48,000 premises. So they created the expectation that there was the capacity to deliver a much larger number of people a service, when in fact there was not. The second shocking mistake they made was allow retail service providers to sell, in effect, uncapped schemes with no data allowance, as though they were selling products in the city, services in the city. As a result of that, the satellite service to the 48,000 people who have got it has become overcrowded, and many people, most people on that, are getting a lot of the time a very poor service. It is a complete shambles. The combination on this issue of the previous government of not telling the truth and absolute incredible incompetence has been absolutely deadly for people in the bush, and it is an appalling state of affairs, and I'm trying to find some solutions to it at the moment. It is not difficult. As with most messes the Labor Party has made, the only solution is spending even more money, and we're working on that now. Right, let's thank the lady for the question.
We'll just hear from the other politician on the panel, and then we'll move on.
I'm a bit with Barry O'Farrell on this. This is a government that needs to stop acting like an opposition and start acting like a government. We haven't heard... I was waiting for Malcolm to answer the questioner and explain when she's going to get her internet. And we didn't hear it. We're working on it.
I said in 2015 the long-term satellites will be
which
here.
Which the previous government put in place. So thank you very much, Malcolm.
The problem is the lies your colleagues told about the interim service in the meantime.
All right, I think we got that point.
This is a huge piece of national infrastructure. Malcolm, regrettably, is condemning Australia to a second-rate broadband service, and that's my regret.
OK, let's move on to other subjects. The next question is from Renilda de Lima Freuland.
A recent Fairfax report featured a detailed interview with the asylum seeker who made the original allegation against the Navy. It has triggered unanswered questions about the validity of the ABC's report on asylum seekers' hands versus the government's attack on the ABC. Will the government come clean now by allowing an independent inquiry?
Janet Albrechtsen, let's start with you. Should the government have an independent inquiry into the recent Fairfax publication of a long interview with one of the asylum seekers, the original one, who made the allegations that naval personnel deliberately burnt the hands of asylum seekers?
I think on the current evidence, the answer has to be no, because, yes, you have the original person who made those allegations, who was not burnt on that boat. He has stuck to his story, and yet, as the Australian has uncovered, one of the asylum seekers who was burnt on that boat, who's a 20-year-old, has said that no, it wasn't. He wasn't tortured by the Navy. That he incurred burns because he fell on the engine.
Oh, can I just make the point that, to be precise, that is not inconsistent with the story told in Fairfax. The story was that gentleman, during the confrontation, fell over, burnt his hands, and the allegation is subsequently, the hands of three others were burnt. He witnessed it allegedly. This is the chap who is interviewed by Fairfax, allegedly witnessed this subsequent to that.
Apart from this one man, there is no one else who has given evidence that they were burned or that they were tortured, as this one man has suggested, by the Navy. Now, on the basis of that, I think we would wait for more information to come forward. If there are other asylum seekers coming forward and saying, yes, they were their burns were inflicted by Navy personnel, you might expect there to be an investigation. On the basis of one person, nothing much has changed.
Well, actually, I'll slightly correct you. There was another witness in the Fairfax story who said that people after the incident with burnt hands told him their hands had been deliberately burnt. So that was a second witness,
Tony,
who didn't
also,
see
there was also the spokesperson for these asylum seekers who originally made the allegation that, yes, he wasn't on the boat, he just became the spokesperson for these asylum seekers. He originally said that the Navy were to blame for these burns that had been inflicted on asylum seekers, and now he's retracted his story. So I don't think there's enough evidence to call for an investigation into allegations that our Navy personnel tortured asylum seekers. I think there is enough scepticism about what people in desperate circumstances will say to understand why they may have said it, but that doesn't necessarily justify there being an investigation at this point.
Okay, let's hear from the rest of our panel. We'll start with Yolanda and then we'll go to Mark Dreyfus.
I think if we go on the he said, she said, he said, we're going to go around in circles. And I would suggest we just take a little bit of a step back here and understand that this country was populated by migrants, asylum seekers, and people from every nation, hence why we've got this incredibly multicultural environment that we eat and drink and live in, one of the luckiest countries in the world. I think it's also important to note that a lot of the asylum seekers that have come to this country have created incredible businesses, successful businesses, and these businesses are part of our community. And we need to stop focusing on these minor details. I'm not implying for one second that somebody getting their hands burnt is minor, but I think when the media pays so much attention to one particular case, we lose focus of the bigger picture, and that is that we live in a multicultural society that has been formed thanks to the asylum seekers, the migrants, and people from everywhere else in the world.
OK, I'll go to Mark Dreyfus, and the question specifically asked, should there be a new or an investigation of the claims made in the Fairfax newspaper?
To Ranilla's question, of course there should be an investigation. I'd be amazed if our Navy, who are very thorough, have not already started an investigation. And that's what our armed forces do. When there are allegations of misconduct or abuse, they investigate. And what is missing here is that the government is wanting to keep it all secret. And it's the government, by its secrecy here, that is creating the cloud of suspicion that our Navy is presently enduring.
I'm going to use a big word. That's what totalitarian regimes do, keep things secret. That is a concern, you know that.
It was the release of the ship's logs that... Well, thanks, Dave, but it was the release of the ship's logs that showed us that John Howard had misled the Australian people during the Children Overboard affair back in 2004. And I am asking the government here and now to end this extraordinary and unwarranted secrecy surrounding the operations that are being carried out, in our name. We need to know what's being done, and of course there should be an inquiry, and one allegation should be absolutely ample. I disagree with Janet.
Can I just quickly come in?
She wants to defend the government on this.
No, I don't.
You want to defend the secrecy,
perhaps. No, you know what I want to defend? I want to defend a proper immigration policy where the boats stop, where people stop drowning at sea, right? And the fact is that the boats, for the last 4 to 6 weeks, have stopped. Last January, January 2013, there were 10 boats, 465 asylum seekers. Now, I don't care what the government does, whether they talk to the media or not. I want to see an end, and I think most Australians want to see an end to the boats arriving illegally in this country.
We want to know what's happening. Tony Abbott today, I read in The Australian, which I've now subscribed to. And
brilliant.
Which is, I wanted to put it as my password biased, and they said that's weak. But he said he doesn't want to let anything out.
If you said ABC bias, it would be much stronger.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's right. He said he didn't want to give ammunition to his critics. What? Ammunition
no,
to his
smugglers.
Critics?
No, he said his smugglers.
Critics. I'll go show it to you. It's on my phone. Do you want me to get it?
No, I don't.
It's your newspaper.
This is about stopping the people smuggling.
But
he said
it was a good humanitarian outcome, what's going on now. So, what? Do they get to take their lifeboats back to Afghanistan, do they? What goes on? I mean, these people are still.
I think it's better that people are not drowning at sea. I think that's a good humanitarian outcome.
Well, that's true. I'll do that. But still, these people are left in the middle.
Okay, we've got a gentleman with his hand up there. Just hang on, though, because I just want to hear from Malcolm Turnbull on this. First of all, the question was, should there be an investigation into the claims made in the Fairfax newspaper, which is an expansion of claims originally reported by
the ABC?
I
think the question was, should there be an independent investigation, by which I understood the questioner to mean, should there be an investigation outside of the Navy? Because what Mark said about the Navy obviously looks very thoroughly into all of these things, and I don't think there should be. I don't think there's nearly enough of a case made. You know, one of the additional bits of evidence you tendered was somebody had told somebody that something had happened. Well, I mean, that wouldn't even be admissible to hearsay. So
don't they have video of this? Don't the Navy video
look,
stuff?
Look, can I just say this to you? And this is where Janet summed it up very well, so I'm not going to repeat what she said. The bottom line is this. A lot of people are very resentful that the government's policy is working. They don't like the fact that the boats have been stopped. They resent that. They're cross that the government has been successful. They didn't believe Tony Abbott when he said he was going to stop the boats.
He now thinks he's Winston Churchill, honestly.
No, but the boats have not completely stopped, but they are certainly well on the way to stopping, and there has been a dramatic reduction, and that has been done through an extraordinary effort by the Navy and other parts of our defence forces who are putting their lives on the line in the most difficult situations out on the ocean there, often in very small boats, dealing with in a very difficult, you can just imagine the difficulties of managing these situations. Now, they're getting this job done, and I'm not saying that everyone's got to line up and say they're wonderful, but the fact is they're getting the job done, and the reason they are not publishing everything that they do every day is because they've taken the view that in order to get that job done, they have to maintain operational security and that degree of confidentiality, and it's working. And
Malcolm,
look,
what if one of the boats, they turn around the lifeboats, what if that sinks and people drown? Will we hear about that? No, because it's a secret and we're not allowed to hear about it.
Well, that's, you know, these
well,
are...
Well, it can happen.
You have no reason to say that. The fact of the matter is...
Well, they're a lot safer in a big Navy boat than they are being dragged back in a lifeboat. There's a lot safer in a Navy boat, aren't they?
Well, the fact of the matter is that the lifeboats that have been on television, those orange boats, and in the newspapers, are almost unsinkable. That's one of the reasons they're lifeboats. So I just make no other comment than that.
Let's just hear from that gentleman who had his hand up earlier. Thank you.
Yeah, given that we're precluding those who are coming here by sea, my question to the panel in general, do you think it would be more appropriate to take in more refugees from places we know are legitimate, like UN refugee camps, for example?
OK, we'll take that as a comment. The lady behind you wanted
to
say something.
We have cut our intake, haven't we? Have we cut our intake?
Just hang on for one sec. Let's hear from the lady behind you as well. Go ahead.
But just adding to what you said, Mr. Turnbull, is that I don't think Australians are disappointed about the boats. I think it's the secrecy behind what we feel that the Abbott government is doing. I feel that you are taking Australia back to an archaic form of dictatorship under the guise of democracy.
Well, Australia is a democracy. We've just had a by-election on Saturday as one taste of democracy. There'll be a number of elections this year and you'll have a chance to vote for the federal government in 2016. So we are very much a democracy. We are very much accountable. Having said that, it is important that the Navy and, well, the Defence Forces generally and the whole border protection, Operation Sovereign Borders, is able to manage this incredibly difficult task effectively, and that requires a degree of operational secrecy or confidentiality. Now, what's happened is that the program is working. The only way we can stop people drowning at sea is stopping people smugglers selling tickets on these rickety boats to come across the ocean. And the only way you can do that is by depriving them of the product they're trying to sell, which means one way or another ensuring the people that get onto those boats cannot get to Australia. As I've said on this program before, I'm not suggesting this is a lovely, touchy-feely policy. The status quo under Labor was incredibly cruel. People were dying at sea. What we're doing is a harsh policy, I grant you that, but it's a lot better than hundreds of people drowning in the ocean.
OK, all right. I'm sorry we have to move on. So we've got a couple of other questions. We are running out of time. The next question is also really a question in the communications area. It's from Jack Yang, I beg your pardon.
Thanks, Tony. Mr. Turnbull and Ms. Albrechtsen, when other countries are pouring large amount of money into the international broadcast operations, ABC has been in a lot of speculation in the past couple of weeks of its future fundings. So let's look at the numbers. The Australian network operated by ABC is now relayed through 679 rebroadcasters in the region, reaching 131 million people. ABC's partnerships have extended its digital reach by 109% in the past 6 months. One of the example is ABC's English learning community has got 900,000 followers when BBC got about 498,000 and Voice of America got 662,000. So Janet and Malcolm, if you think ABC is not doing the job precisely and quietly fulfilling its brief about its responsibility, why do media partners across the Indo-Pacific Ocean stand up to the network again and again?
Now, I should say we did check to make sure that Jack does not work for the Australian Network or the ABC. It has to be said. He just came to us straight. So, Janet Albrechtsen.
I guess I'm, one of those people who have watched the Australian Network many times overseas, and I'm not quite sure what it's trying to do. I understand what the contract with the ABC is, and we've heard from Mark Scott on taking soft diplomacy into Asia. I really believe that the Department of Foreign Affairs could do a much better job. I don't see that the Australian Network you talk about the reach that it has. It's got a tiny audience. It's basically expats watching the Australian Network. It's 220 million over 10 years. I reckon DFAT could do a whole lot better in pursuing soft diplomacy in Asia. I think when I look at, what's happened in America...
You think all those, 900,000 expats are learning to speak English?
No. I think they're watching, I think the only reason they watch Australian Network is so they can watch a bit of footy occasionally.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing wrong with that. I don't want to subsidise that, Dave. Again, you probably want to subsidise it. I don't want to subsidise it, right? So, and I think it's a problem not just for the ABC, by the way. I think it's a problem for any news outlet in Australia. There is a conflict between being a news, independent news outlet and all that that entails, and then running a channel in Asia with the aim of pursuing soft diplomacy. I think that's an inherent conflict. And even Alexander Downer, you don't often hear politicians say they got it wrong. He admitted about a week ago that Cabinet were pretty iffy about this. John Howard was certainly iffy about it. He took it into Cabinet, he pushed it, they agreed, and he said, I got it wrong. It wasn't the right thing to do.
OK, let's hear from the Communications Minister. Do you think it'll be shut down? I mean, in the newspaper the other day, you were suggesting putting ABC 24, which is a purely domestic output, onto that international transmission line. Of course, that would make it rather difficult to keep those partnerships.
No, well, that's not what I was suggesting, actually. Look, whether...
You were misquoted by the Australian?
No. this is the point I was making. Firstly,
because Barnaby Joyce was on the show last week making the same claim.
I think you misread it. whether this $27 million a year is good value for the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade is a decision for Julie Bishop, not for me, right? I'm the minister for the responsible ultimately for the ABC, but it's not my decision about spending that money. However, I think the point, Mr. Yang, that I'd make to this to you, is that the internet itself has trumped all these other platforms. The reality is that if you want to get your Australian news, your Australian message out to the greatest number of people, it should be streamed over the internet and available on the internet. That is the most pervasive platform. It is the hyper platform. It has trumped everything else.
That's going to kill our global data roaming charges. That is why
Bruce Dover, who used to run Australia Network, some years ago, has made exactly the same point that if you wanted to have an Australian, say ABC News 24 available globally, then spend a bit of money to clear, so there are some copyright issues, clear those issues, and then it can just stream over the internet globally as it does within Australia. And that would mean that anywhere in the world, anyone with a smartphone would be able to, or internet connected television or computer, would be able to see what is happening in Australia, according to ABC News 24, at any time. Now, I think that is a very, very powerful argument. I think you can do so much more
with the internet.
Is it a powerful...
Can I interrupt you? Have you concluded that there is here waste, that this money is actually wasted? I mean, it's $225 million or so over 10 years. Is it your conclusion that that is a place where waste can be cut out of the budget?
Well,
that's the implication, and that's obviously what The Australian is saying in their editorials, etc. So is that your view?
No, my view is that ultimately, as to whether that $27 million a year is a good investment on soft diplomacy, is a decision for Julie Bishop and the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. But if you're asking me, as someone who's been around communications for a while and has got an interest in it, both professional and historical, I would say that if I wanted to get the message of the ABC to the widest possible global audience and ABC News to the widest global possible audience, I would be streaming it and making it available over the internet globally, as we do in Australia.
Except for Tasmania, then you'd have trouble there.
Okay, look, I'm told I'm going to cut you off there because I'm told we've got time for one last question. It does come from Jared Hosier. We haven't got a lot of time to answer it, so we'll get short answers from everybody. Go ahead.
Okay, should Australia's proceeds of crime law be applied to Schapelle Corby for her exclusive interviews, books, films, in the same way that it was attempted to be applied to David Hicks? And does the litmus test of equality of the law for all, that is, putting someone of a different race or gender or religion or appearance into the same situation of that law, would we always prosecute it
Okay, let's take the simpler part of your question, which is, should the proceeds of crime legislation be used to try and stop Schapelle Corby making money from
her
story?
Or is it furry bunny?
Dave?
I reckon I hope a network pays her $10 million and gets zero ratings from it. It's a circus, an absolute circus.
best answer I'm after,
yeah? Yolanda, what do you think?
Look, I think the notion of a free press for the last few centuries has been basically about ratings, and the ratings are required in order to get their advertising up. So, to answer your question and the one prior to that, we need agencies like the ABC to deliver the truth, because the multinationals only deliver infotainment, and we've had enough of the infotainment to last us for another couple of centuries, I think, with Corby.
Let's hear from Mark Dreyfus, former Attorney General, so you might know whether the proceeds of crime legislation actually works in this case, since she will be living in Bali.
I think most Australians take a pretty dim view of anyone profiting from crime. That's why we have proceeds of crime legislation. And I'm not going to comment on the situation that Schapelle Corby is in because she's in Indonesia. She's subject to Indonesian law.
So, does that mean, you say you're not going to comment on it, but what you're saying imply that she's beyond the reach of Australian law? This legislation won't touch her.
Schapelle Corby,
so the networks can give her as much money as they want. Is that correct?
Schapelle Corby is in Indonesia on parole for quite some time. and I think everybody should be very conscious of the need for her to abide parole conditions. And
well, I don't think her parole conditions preclude her getting $3 million from Channel 7, for example.
She's in Indonesia, subject to Indonesian law.
OK. Janet Albrechtsen, it sounds like the proceeds of crime legislation won't actually apply to Schapelle Corby if she remains in Bali.
Look, I'm so glad that you asked that question because I've always wanted to come on Q&A and give this answer. I have absolutely no interest in the subject of Schapelle Corby.
A quick answer from Malcolm Turnbull, whose interest in this subject is burning away.
Yeah, it's burning away. On this matter, I concur with my learned friend, the former Attorney General.
I'm afraid that's all we have time for tonight. We really do have to go. Please thank our panel, Malcolm Turnbull, Dave Hughes, Yolanda Vega, Mark Dreyfus and Janet Albrechtsen. Thank you. Now, next Monday, and there are plenty of questions on this subject we didn't get to, on the subjects of employment and so on we didn't get to, but you'll be able to ask them next week because we have the Minister for Employment, Erica Betts, we have the Shadow Minister for Finance, Tony Burke, we have the Law Professor, James Allen, who argues that some lawyers and judges are undermining democracy and free speech, oil rig engineer and founder of Youth Without Borders, Yasmin Abdel-Majid. We'll have one more panellist to be announced, but until next week, good night.